All right, good morning. It's good to be with you. As Amy mentioned, if you've been around First Christian for very long, you know that we love to help ordinary people become extraordinary neighbors. Realize that's what God's created you for. It's why I'm excited about this series and believe that in these 4 weeks, God will elevate many of our relationship with Jesus as we learn to love the thing that Jesus loves most, which is people. If you were with us last week, you know we discovered that if we're going to excel at neighboring, we must first understand that over the last 75 years, significant shifts have taken place in our society that changed the way that we neighbor. For example, around the middle of the 20th century, architecture in our neighborhoods and shifts in the places that we call home changed the way we interact with those around us. Around the middle of the 20th century, as millions of veterans were coming home from war and we experienced a booming economy, we saw the establishment of the suburbs. And for the first time, neighbors did not find in their neighborhood a sense of place and belonging as much as they did of safety and comfort. And rather than extending themselves onto their front porch, they begin to withdraw into the safety and confines of their home. And whereas neighbors before that had enjoyed engaging neighbors outside in the streets, now once more neighbors really kind of took to indoors. And it changed the way that we live alongside one another. We said that because of our pace of life, many of us in our commitments and our commutes and our family activities have little margin to engage in meaningful ways with those around us. We also said that because of the emergence of modern-day media, all you have to do is turn on the evening news, and it doesn't take long to figure out that there's some crazy people out there. And some of us are concerned that we might have a crazy neighbor, right? And some of you are the crazy neighbor. Isn't that true? You just embrace that in the name of Jesus, okay? So I was asking my neighbors, you know, I'm asking my friends, hey, is this for real? Have you ever had a crazy neighbor? And several of them said, we have had crazy neighbors. So for example, one of my friends in New England, he had a friend, a neighbor whose last name was Polychronopoulos. That's like as legit Greek as you can get. And while they were living next to them, get this, they decided to transform their 1960s era split level into a Greek palace. And so they built columns on the front of these because, you know, the Greeks loved split levels. And if you've ever lived next to like a full Polychronopoulos Greek family, you know, that can get a little crazy, okay? Then I had another friend who said, yeah, we had a neighbor who actually owned a limo. Okay, that's crazy. But not only did they own a limo, they couldn't fit the limo in the garage. So rather than shutting the door on the limo or parking the limo out in the driveway, they parked their limo in the garage, put a queen-size mattress on top of it, and shut the garage door anyway, okay? So you got to protect that limo at all costs. I don't even know why you own a limo, but you do. One other neighbor, get this. One other neighbor said, we actually had someone in the neighborhood who bred praying mantises for a living because they believed that that would take care of all the other pest problems in the neighborhood. So we just had a bunch of praying mantises around the neighborhood. So you got some crazy neighbors, okay? Some of you have a crazy neighbor. Some of you are legitimately the crazy neighbor that everyone else is talking about, and that's okay. God's going to do great things through you anyway, all right? But the reality is society has shifted, okay? And our pace of life has changed. And all of us can come up with reasons for why being a neighbor is neither practical or convenient. But it doesn't change the timeless words and calling of Jesus on our lives, when in Mark 12, he said, listen, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And then he said, the second is equally important. He said, out of all the 600 plus commands of the Jewish people, if you wanted to distill them down into the heart of God's law, love God with everything you are, and the second is equally important, love your neighbor as yourself. He says, nothing else is greater. He says, love your neighbor as yourself. And if you missed that message, you can go online and catch up with us. But today we want to continue where we started off, where we were in Jeremiah chapter 29. And we finished that message with a particular calling of God to the people of Israel as they were living in a pagan land, Babylon, in exile, where God had taken them. And he said, listen, as you establish yourself in that land, verse 7, I want you to work for the peace and prosperity of the city where I sent you into exile. I want you to pray to the Lord for it, for its welfare will determine your welfare. He says, I want you to work for the peace and prosperity of the city. Today, I want to look at where we begin to work for the peace and prosperity of our city by considering one simple step that each of us can take that really, I believe, is the beginning of all extraordinary neighboring. It's the one step where all neighboring begins. And I want to give you this story to kind of begin to set it up. If you know the life story of Mother Teresa, you know that it began before she actually worked in the streets of Calcutta. From 1931 to 1948, she worked in a convent in Calcutta where she went about the life of a nun. But it was in her encounters, looking through the windows of her convent onto the city streets, that she began to get glimpses of what life was like, so that in 1948, she requested permission to leave the convent and actually begin ministry on the streets, to where for the next 6 decades, she cared for the poorest of the poor in the most difficult of circumstances in Calcutta. Now, what's fascinating about Mother Teresa, one of the many things, is that when asked how she could work in that kind of setting and not become overwhelmed by the need around us, Mother Teresa said this. She said, when I looked out at the crowds, I did not see the masses, but I saw the individual within the crowd. She said, when I looked at all the need, had I considered everything around me, my heart would have been overwhelmed. She said, but I didn't look at the crowds. I saw the person in the midst of the crowd. And if you know anything about Mother Teresa, you know that she took her cues from Jesus. I mean, Jesus was a master at seeing into the crowds to a single person, wasn't he? I think about the moment that Jesus interrupted a funeral procession and he saw the crowds who were getting ready to bury the boy of a young mother, and Jesus stopped the funeral, went through the crowds, engaged the young woman, raised her son to life, stopped the funeral, and sent him home with her. In another moment, if you know the story of a man named Zacchaeus, Jesus was surrounded by crowds of people who were cheering him on to become an earthly king as he neared Jerusalem. But rather than giving in to the whims of the ones of the crowd, Jesus stopped at a tree and engaged a man living on the fringes of society and said, hey, I got to come to your house. Had a party with Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus' life was transformed because he saw the individual through the crowd. Another example, Jesus, early on in his ministry, was surrounded by religious leaders, but rather than pandering to their requests and wants, Jesus saw a man living on the fringes of society, engaging in one of the most hated occupations of his day as a tax collector. We know him as Levi, but you might actually know him as Matthew. Jesus called Levi to follow him. His life was changed. He ends up writing a gospel, the Gospel of Matthew, to chronicle the life events of Jesus. And in doing so, Jesus shows us what can happen when you see through the crowds into the individuals within the crowd. Now, Jesus not only practiced this, this has been practiced culturally for centuries by people throughout the world. There's an underlying assumption or acknowledgement or known fact that when the crowds are around you, if you see the individual and engage them, it can change their life. There's a tribe in northern South Africa, of which Peter Senge writes, that actually engages one another as individuals, not as a faceless person within the crowd. And Peter Senge describes their greeting. He says, among the northern Natal and South Africa, the most common greeting, which is equivalent to hello in English, is the expression sawubona. It literally means, I see you. If you're a member of the tribe, you might reply by saying, Sakona, I am here. The order of the exchange is important. Until you see me, I do not exist. But when you see me, it's as though you bring me into existence. And wasn't that the very way of Jesus? I mean, Jesus, time after time, saw people within the face of the crowd. And he not only practiced sawubona, he modeled that for us, and he called us to do the same. In fact, one of the great stories that Jesus told, he says, if you want to become an extraordinary neighbor, you've got to begin to see people. In fact, I want to read it for you in Luke chapter 10. Maybe you've heard it before, but as we read this narrative, if you have or have not heard it before, notice the way that Jesus calls us to see others. Here's his words. He says, a Jewish man was traveling on a trip from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him for dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along, but when he, what? When he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant walked over and looked at the man lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. Jesus says, the next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here. I want you to notice the way that Jesus contrasts the way that the 3 people in his story engage the man lying in the middle of the road. It says all 3 observed the man, didn't they? But 2 went on while 1 went toward. It says all 3 observed the man. All 3 were busy. All 3 had places to go. All 3 had people to see. There was business they needed to attend to. But 2 men observed the man and went on. Only 1 observed him and went toward. And he says, in the same way, I want you to be like the man who saw and went toward. Now, the reality is that most of us will not engage someone who's lying in the middle of the road today, right? But if you do, be prepared and move toward. I think Jesus' story applies best to us in the ordinary moments of our ordinary days, where we have opportunities to engage people and decide in that moment whether we will see and move to or see and move on. For example, you have someone who moves into your neighborhood and they live not far from you. And in that moment, you have an opportunity to welcome them to the neighborhood or the apartment complex or the living center where you're at. And you have an opportunity to engage them and say, hey, you matter and I'm glad you're here and be a neighbor. But in that moment, isn't it true that most of us say, I've got things to do. I've got details to attend to. My time is full. And so rather than moving to, we move away from, because it's always easier to move on, isn't it? Many of us have colleagues at work who are going through difficult seasons, but because our plate is full and we have deadlines to meet, rather than taking time to listen and encourage, we move on, determining to come back around when our task list frees up. How many of you have ever had a day when your task list frees up, right? It's easier to move on, isn't it? Some of us have friends who encounter significant financial setback, and it's a God-given opportunity in those moments to care for them in a practical way where we can be a blessing to them. But all of us have our own financial commitments and bills to pay, so we move on determining that when we have more financial margin, we'll come back around to address that need. How many of you ever feel like you have the financial margin to meet someone else's need, right? So it's easier to move on. Wherever you're at in the ordinary moments of the day, whether you're engaging with a barista at your coffee shop or a server at the restaurant you frequent or another student appear at the school hallway that you walk, you have opportunities every day to learn their name and their life story so you can share your life with theirs. But it's always easier to move on rather than to move forward, isn't it? But listen, Jesus will not let you go there. He will not let us stay there. In fact, his parable isn't simply a good feel story about how you and I should kind of go out of our way to love people. Notice the details in the story. It's really profound. He doesn't just give us 3 ordinary people, one of whom changed the life of a man lying in the middle of the road. He sets up the story by setting up the social paradigm that existed in that day. He said there was a Jewish man lying in the middle of the road, and 2 of his Jewish brothers come by. They see their Jewish brother lying on the ground, but they move on. But it's the Samaritan man who comes by, sees a Jewish enemy lying in the middle of the road, and moves toward him. Everyone listening to Jesus' story would have known that for centuries there had been bad blood between Jews and Samaritans. Racism, division, hatred. And so no Jewish man lying in the middle of the road would have seen a Samaritan man approaching and thought, this man will help. In fact, he would have thought there will be no help from this half-breed. But instead, Jesus places the hero of the story in the center of a centuries-old controversy and says it's the Samaritan man who extends himself on behalf of whom everyone else would have considered his enemy. And he says, in the same way, extraordinary neighbors aren't simply people who see those who are like them and draw near to them. Extraordinary neighbors are people who see anyone like or unlike them and draw near to them. Jesus says extraordinary neighbors are those who are willing to slow down long enough to notice people we cross paths with. Jesus says in his parable, listen, extraordinary neighbors are those who are willing to move toward people even when it's inconvenient. Those extraordinary neighbors are those people who are willing to see people the world doesn't see. And even to see people the world doesn't want to see. Jesus says extraordinary neighbors are those who are willing to draw near to other people even when it costs them deeply. And Jesus says, I want you to become these extraordinary neighbors. And neighboring begins with seeing. So the question you and I must ask is, do we actually see our neighbors? Do we see them? In fact, to help you answer this question, I want to give you a little exercise. It's possible that a few of you have seen this exercise before, and if so, don't say, I've seen that exercise, okay? Instead, ask, is it motivating me to see others in a new way? Am I growing in this area? But for many of you, this will be a new image. I'll show you an image on the screen, and I just want to give some context for it, and then I want to lead you through a little exercise. This is called a neighborhood map, and it reflects many of the neighborhoods in which we live. For some of you, you don't live in a neighborhood that's like a quadrant or a tic-tac-toe board. You live maybe in an apartment complex where you've got 80 neighbors, not eight. You might live in a rural space where there's significant distance between you and others. You might live in a senior home where there are many more neighbors around you than just what's represented here, but that doesn't matter. What matters is that this represents those who live in closest proximity to you and I. And what I want you to do is for a moment, I'm actually going to give you some time to do this, consider the people who live in closest proximity to you. In fact, consider the neighbors, the eight neighbors who live on either side, behind and front, and to the left and right of you. I'm going to give you 30 seconds, and here's what I want you to do. I want you to do your best, whether you're writing this down or you get out your phone and you record it or you just get into your mind. I want you to write down the eight neighbors, the eight peers in school, the eight people in a rural setting who live up and down the road, the eight people who live closest to you. And I just want you to write their name down. Will you do that? 30 seconds. Here we go. We'll play some music while we're doing this. Go. All right, yeah, 10 seconds left, okay? We'll get a little dance party going on in here while you do this. All right, 5 seconds. All right. Now, listen, you may want to go home and continue this on. We just had a moment right in the middle of a church service, all right? And some of you wanted to get up and dance, but don't do that, okay? Just joking. You can dance. Here's what I want you to do. Here's what I want you to do. No show of hands here, but I just want you to get in your mind who those eight neighbors are. Now, here's the deal. This research has been done all across churches, all across our country. And here's what we found as we've seen these taking place. Only 10% of churchgoers can name all eight of the neighbors who live in closest proximity to them. Only one out of 10 churchgoers can name all eight of the neighbors living in closest proximity to them. Now it continues. Check this out. Only 3% of neighbors who attend church can name one significant detail about each of those eight neighbors. Only 3%. One in 33 of those in this room can name our neighbors and one significant detail about their lives. Furthermore, less than 1% of those in this room can not only name our neighbors and a detail about their lives, but have actually connected with those neighbors in a significant way. Less than 4 people in this room. Now, listen, as you walk through this exercise, let me ask you a question. If loving our neighbors begins with seeing our neighbors, how many of you would agree that it's difficult to see our neighbors if we don't even know their name? How many of you would agree? Difficult to see your neighbor if you don't even know their name, isn't it? That's right. And so if you walk through this exercise and you're like, I know every neighbor. In fact, I know details. In fact, I've connected in a significant way, and you're one of the 4 in this room, be encouraged, okay? Not haughty, encouraged, all right? And keep going. But listen, if you're one of the 397 of us in the room who would say, man, I don't think I can do it. In fact, I can't even name all 8 of my neighbors. Don't be discouraged, but instead be compelled by Jesus' story to begin living in a new way. In his book, Whistling in the Dark, Frederick Buechner, who's a great 20th century poet, philosopher, author, theologian, writes this about what it will take for you and I to begin to actually see our neighbors. He says, when Jesus comes along saying that the greatest command of all is to love God and to love our neighbor, he too is asking us to pay attention, to be aware. He says, if we're to love our neighbors before doing anything, we must see our neighbors with our imagination as well as with our eyes. That is to say, like artists, we must not just see their faces, but the life behind and within their faces. And here it is love that's the frame we see them in. I love that image. He says, if you're to actually see, this isn't just talking about getting a glimpse of someone who lives to the left or right of you. He's saying, like an artist, we actually want to begin with our imaginations to engage people, meaning we want to begin to envision the vision God might have for their lives. We want to begin to share in God's dream for our neighbors and colleagues. You can apply this in the workspace. He says, we not only want to get a glimpse of them, we actually want to draw near to them and see them, behold them in such a way that would compel us to move toward rather than drawing away. Buechner's right. He says, we got to learn to see in a whole new way. And if we're going to learn to see, I think it's going to take some practical steps. And if you're asking, well, how do I begin to see those around me in a new way? I want to give you a few of those steps, suggest them for you if you're taking notes. But first, I'll suggest to you something that I've tried over the years that hasn't necessarily worked and Beth discourages me from. Okay? For years, I thought, man, none of my neighbors, you know, in a particular neighborhood would even look at me. I don't know what that means about me, okay? But they wouldn't really engage with me. And so what I began to do, I don't promote this, maybe discourage it, it might be effective for you, is I would go into my driveway while they're outside and I would just stare at them until they turned around. And then I would wave. I would stop staring. That's a critical point. And then you wave and engage. Beth says I'm a creepy neighbor when I do that. I disagree, okay? I'm just a strategic neighbor. But I'm not recommending that. I think there are more practical, probably less apparent or less obvious ways to begin to see those around you. Let me give you a few examples. Number one, as I told you last week, and I'll continue to encourage you, I think the first step to becoming an extraordinary neighbor is to begin by praying. To ask God to give you eyes to see those around you. I was in Colorado Springs this week with some great friends and other pastors around the country, and we were staying at the beautiful resort right at the base of Garden of the Gods, and it overlooks Pikes Peak. I want to show you an image. This is what Pikes Peak looks like in the Garden of Gods on a normal day. It's beautiful, isn't it? I mean, it's stunning. I was there for 3 days, and this was my view for all 3 days. All 3 days. We didn't see a mountain in 3 days, middle of October. In fact, it rained every day except for Wednesday, on which it snowed the entire day. I flew in and out, never seeing a mountain. Okay? Unfortunately, I've been there many times. I've seen mountains, but it was completely discouraging. Visibility was low. And I give you that image because I do believe and have experienced that if I am prayerless in my desire to be a neighbor that Jesus calls me to be, my visibility diminishes considerably. I will not see the people around me in the way Jesus sees them or the way he calls me to see. However, when I begin to pray in simple ways, God, would you give me your eyes to see those around me? I am amazed by how my visibility begins to clear up. And God begins to give me glimpses of people around me and their names and their stories and the dreams he has for their lives in ways I had never seen before. And so I believe extraordinary neighboring begins with prayer. And we're encouraging you this whole series to pray one simple prayer. We call it praying for one. And it goes like this: God, would you give me one person to show your love to today? God, would you give me one person to show your love to today? How many of you think that's a simple prayer? You could pray that. God, give me one person to show your love to. I say it like this: God, give me one person to listen to today. God, give me one person to encourage today. God, give me one person to care for today. God, give me one person to recognize a need in their life and maybe have an opportunity to meet that need today. And I have found that when I begin praying, when friends who are praying the same prayer begin praying, that God opens our eyes to see. Now, let me give you some examples of how that happens. Whether for Beth and I and our friends, whether it's the neighborhood we live in and we begin to see our neighbors, whether it's the gym I go to, some of you are like, you actually go to a gym? Look at you, Mullinex, you need to keep going. Whether you say that, all right, I do go to a gym. I do a lot of talking there, but I go to a gym, all right? And I recognize in those moments, it's not only about lifting weights, it's about the people in that space. And so I'm praying, God, let me just not see other guys who are bigger than me, who are lifting weights, but let me see guys that I can know. And so I pray over them, and God has opened up doors for me to have friendship in those spaces. And it's the restaurants Beth and I go to, and we say, God, would you just give us eyes for the people that are serving us or taking care of us that day? And we just practically walk through this. And I'll tell you what happens. God does it. God gives us eyes to see people in the way he sees them. And then you take it a step forward. Here's another step. Not only do you see them, but you move toward them rather than away. And I found that one of the greatest ways to move toward someone is to simply know their name. In fact, I love how Andrew Carnegie wrote about the significance of a name, or Dale Carnegie. He said, a person's name is to him or her the sweetest sound in any language. And so I've found that remembering names of neighbors I come across is so important. So I actually write them down in my phone because I can forget names just like most of us. And it gives me the opportunity to pray for them. And then as you begin to learn names and they begin to recognize you know their name, you move toward them and you begin to learn their story. And I'll just give you this as a practical example. When you begin to ask good questions of those you live beside or shop beside or work beside, good questions about their life and where they came from and what their story is and how they got where they're at and why they're working there and how they came to live here, and you begin to trace their life story, they begin to share more than you ever ask for, and all of a sudden you begin to have a friend or you experience a neighbor relationship. And you begin to see them in a new way, not just as a person across the street or in the cubicle beside or in the hallway that you cross paths with every day, but you begin to see a story. And you begin to learn their hopes and their dreams, and you begin to experience their hurts and their fears, and God begins to create a connection in a way that we see in Luke 19. And all of a sudden, now you not only have a distant stranger, but a close neighbor that you can learn to love in the way Jesus calls us to, ordinary ways that become extraordinary. Jesus says that followers of him become extraordinary neighbors when they learn to see those around them. I love it how he says it in this way. I'll give you this and then apply it and we'll wrap. In Matthew chapter 9, Jesus said, when he saw the crowds, or Matthew's actually writing this. When Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. Notice he saw them. Time and time again, he sees those around. He had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. He said to his disciples, "The harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who's in charge of the harvest. Ask him to send more workers into his fields." Matthew writes, Jesus saw the crowds and had compassion. Let me ask you, how many of you are thankful that Jesus had compassion on the crowds? How many of you are thankful that Jesus had compassion toward you? Yeah. And notice in this setting, Jesus says, "I want you to pray that God will raise up more harvest workers, a movement of people who will see the world as I see it and extend compassion to the world as I've extended it, and who will love their neighbors as I've loved them, and who will become the kind of extraordinary neighbors that I'm calling them to be." Jesus says, if you'll pray that and you'll do that, through you, I can change the world. So I want you to imagine with me today what God might begin to do if you would take a risk and begin to prayerfully move toward people rather than away from them. If you would begin to imagine the dreams God has for their lives rather than simply seeing them and moving on. I want you to imagine what God might do in your neighborhood, in your workspace, as you prayerfully engaged and begin to learn the names of and the stories of those around you. I believe it's the first step to extraordinary neighboring. And I believe God has great plans for your life. And he wants to do great things through your lives. And it begins here when you allow him to show you the way to see those around you. So will you pray with me? And I want to pray that God does this for you. God, we thank you that you have called us to be extraordinary neighbors. We thank you that in our lives you gave compassion to us when we didn't deserve it. We thank you that you had a dream for our life that you saw and brought to pass before we even realized it. We thank you that you loved us when we were at our worst and gave us your best. And we thank you, Jesus, that in this moment you call us to love our neighbors in the same way. And so today I pray for courage to do that. I pray for a spirit of prayerfulness to wash over this place, that we would begin to pray daily, opportunities, asking for them to love those in your name. I pray that you would open doors to care for and encourage, to inspire and motivate, to provide for and provide compassion to those that you place in our path. And God, may our neighboring begin here as we begin to see people in the way you see them. That's our prayer. Jesus, we love you, and we pray these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Hey, we are